month is gone. It's running so fast. But we are still running the race that is set before us. We really don't bother how fast the days are going. What matters is we keeping or maintaining our focus on the race that is set before us and running according to the anointing, according to the grace that He supplies. Hallelujah. According to the ability that He has endowed us with. So we welcome viewers all around the globe. This is Liberty House International Church, Incorporated, and we are coming to you live from the USA. And this is yours truly, a messenger of God, a messenger of the Lord Jesus Christ, a sent one, an agent of change and transformation with a message of change for you. And we thank you for partnering with us to know truth, to be disciples of the Lord Jesus Christ, and to share truth so we can together stop the circulation of junk in the system. You may not know, but because of who I am and what I do, I know that there's so much junk in circulation. There's so much deceit. There's so much deception. There's so much heresy, wrong teaching, wrong beliefs, and what have you. And it bothers me that people genuinely, they are honest in their relationship with God. They've been attending church service, church meetings. They've been Christians for a while. But because of the deceit, deception, the wrong teachings, heresy, false doctrines, they are not progressing. They are not prospering the way they should prosper. And some of them, if you should give them the chance, they are going to load you with a lot of complaints. And it's true. I hear some. A lot of complaints. Because things are not working. You see, when you believe wrongly, you don't have God in the equation. You have to believe His word. When you believe His word, He backs His word. Hallelujah. Amen. Go get Friday's teaching, like I was saying. Wrong teaching is making some people, when they go to God and they are going to pray, they shout commands and instructions at God. It's wrong. You don't do that. You are the lesser. He's the greater. You are going to Him. You are asking Him. You are petitioning Him. You are asking Him to do something for you. You go in boldness, in humility. You don't go and shout instructions. Anyway, for your information, God knows how to take care of Himself. And also, He knows how to take care of His business. It's not like, okay, I'm going there. Somebody will say I'm sounding ugly. Some people don't know how to take care of their business. They need reminders. And a lot of reminders. A lot. God doesn't need a reminder. God knows His job. And He does His job very, very, very excellently. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. All right. So I want to help people to overcome this dullness, the struggle in their walk with God, and not really seeing God manifest Himself in their lives. And I've been teaching on these lines for so many years. And I thank God that He keeps adding. He keeps giving me more revelation about these things. Hallelujah. Amen. So I'm going to share with you along these lines. We are come into blessing. The Bible talks about the cup of blessing. In the book of Corinthians, the cup of blessing. Our communion with Jesus Christ brought us into a place where we can say we are blessed. God has blessed us because we are in communion. We are in union. We are family. If we were not cleansed, and if we were disqualified, if we were unclean, there's no way that we'll be in communion with Jesus Christ. No way. He's too clean, He's too holy, He's too sanctified. But because of our faith in His death, resurrection, and ascension, we came into what? Communion. Fellowship. We became one with Him. Union. Hallelujah. Amen. And God said, we are now joint heirs with Jesus Christ. Joint heirs with Jesus Christ. That's a place of abundance. A place of blessing. Now, there's some argument out there. Some theologians will tell you that is positional. That is positional. I don't care who. Whatever they are saying, When God does anything, it's what? Complete. You can't add to it. You can't take away from it. My concern is, a lot of Christians don't even know that they are blessed. So they say things like, if God should bless me, one day, if God should bless me, and they even go to the extent of praying for God to bless them. And that is why there's this widespread of this, prayer of blessing in Numbers chapter 6, 24 to, and 25. When God spoke to Moses, to Aaron, the high priest then, this is the way you are going to bless the people. Say, the Lord bless you. Can you put it there? 6:24. I want to read the whole thing. Numbers 6:24. The Lord bless you and keep you. Okay, let's back up. I want people to know that what I'm saying is the Bible. I'm not just saying something. Hallelujah. So let's go to 23. Speak to Aaron. We are in Numbers 6:23. Speak to Aaron. Speak to whom? Aaron. So speak to Aaron and his sons, saying, this is the way you shall bless the children of Israel. Say to them. So here, what kind of people, or who are the people that God is addressing? Or Aaron is going to pronounce the blessing upon or address? Who? Children of Israel. Children of Israel. Okay, so say to them specifically at a specific time. Now let's read on. The Lord bless you and keep you. Hallelujah. Now, this prayer wasn't done for Abraham, because the Lord blessed Abraham. And when he blessed him, he was blessed. And he said, I'll make you what? Great. Your name shall even be great. Through you, all the families of the earth shall be blessed. When God said, Abraham, I've made you great, he made him. So there was no need to pronounce any blessing upon Abraham. They have come under law, with a high priest that is, what do you call it? That cannot escape death. Man, high priest that will not escape death. But in Abraham's case, it's God. And I believe it was pointing to Jesus Christ. Our union with Jesus, how God was going to bless us. So let's finish this, and I'll go to, so it says, the Lord bless you and keep you. All right. Let's read on. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. Gracious. People pray now and say, let's stay there for a second. And be gracious to you. Look, this is serious. Today I attempt, if I have time, I'll straighten it up. Some members in the body of Christ, they think they are praying, but they are praying wrong prayers. And I want you to hear me, please hear me carefully, hear me well. Because this is one of the serious concerns that I have. I want people to see results in their prayer life. And some people call this prayer, they have this exercise, but they don't pray scripturally, not according to present truth. And it's so sad. So the word gracious comes from the word grace. So in this time, Jesus had not been born. Jesus had not died. Jesus has not been raised. Jesus had not ascended to heaven. The only way you can get anything from God is just to do what he says do. Laws. 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 And nobody could fulfill the laws or pacify God. Nobody. Over 600 laws. People know just the Ten Commandments. But in addition to the Ten Commandments, there were Chaubuku. Plenty, laws. And the Bible says if you falter in one, you have faltered or you've broken all. Hallelujah. That's what the book of James says. So here, God, look at this. This is the way you are to bless them. So it's like it's on a daily basis. He has to pronounce this on you, then you are blessed. If Aaron doesn't pronounce it, you are not blessed. But when you come, for instance, into John chapter 1, 16, the Bible says, of his fullness, from him we have received grace upon grace. Who is the whom that, or he that we are talking about? Jesus Christ. Amen. Because grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. Amen. He came to give us grace. So with his, our faith in what he has done, we come into grace. Bible says we have received. Let me finish this and we'll go there. I have to take my time. Hallelujah. Amen. So, and be gracious to make his face shine upon you. In other words, to favor you and give you grace. Let's go to the next one. Let me say what things I need to say. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. You see what is going on? But Jesus is the Prince of Peace. Hallelujah. Okay, this is enough. So I've seen people, including pastors, God bless their hearts. I'm not knocking down pastors. This is not a downer, but I'm just telling you the facts. Monkey see, monkey do. And because they are spiritual leaders, and the people have trust in them, what they teach them, some congregants, I'm going to say it like it is. I'm not trying to degrade you. I'm not trying to demean you. I'm telling you what you've been doing that is not okay. And you have to shift gears. You've been lazy, and so you don't set the scriptures. So when they preach any heresy, they tell you a lie, then you just follow like a puppet. It's your duty to search the scriptures. Check out every word that is preached to you to see if it lines up with the word of God, and then you can act on it. That's your duty. Test the spirits. Try the spirits. Prove all things. That is your responsibility. But if you don't study your word, if you don't read your word, you don't know it. That's why I keep telling you that I'm your spiritual leader. If I say anything that does not line up with the word of God, don't do it. Then say, Pastor. So, no, don't do that. You're going to hurt yourself. Hallelujah. Amen. So, some of these pastors, and I heard a particular one, said this year, we are starting differently. So one, we are going to pray for God to give us grace. Wrong. The moment I hear a pastor say this, then I know that this pastor needs to sit down. He needs to be exposed to truth, present truth. He has to change his theology. We have to move him, yank him out from the Old Testament to the New. I'm not making fun of this. I'm not making this light. It bothers me. Because, can you imagine somebody gives you a wrong direction? Will you end up at your destination? That's what is going on. So we are going to pray for grace, for God to give us grace. And then, okay, and then also protect us in this year. We are going to ask for protection for this year. Wrong prayer. So, you gather people. So this is a friend number one thing we are praying for. So we gather people and say, let's pray now. And look, because of ignorance, this simple prayer, even if this is what you're going to ask from God, all right? You're going to ask for God to what? Protect you. You're going to ask God for grace. If you're a believer, I'm talking to the church. If you're a believer, pastor, talking to his congregants. Even if, this is wrong, but I just want to demonstrate. Even if you are going to pray before God for this, it shouldn't take you more than a minute. You can go straight to God and then say, Father, in the name of the Lord Jesus, I'm asking you to protect me. I'm asking you to give me grace to do this or to do that. See how simple? Less than a minute. But ignorance, slapped with tradition, with the belt of tradition, not based on Bible, present truth, they say, okay, so let's all pray. Then they begin. All the drama. They finish this, and then to them, they have prayed. But the Bible tells me, put it there, please. 1 John chapter 5, 14 and 15. This is one of the things I'm called to do. I have the mandate to do it. To free people. To free them from bondage and bring them into truth. How? by teaching them the way, truth. Now, this is the confidence that we have in Him, that if we ask anything according to His will, He hears us. So before you go to God, know your stuff. What are you going to ask for? What are you going to pray about? And what you are going to pray about, is it in line with the will of God? So I would say, oh yeah, yeah. Asking God to protect me is in line with the will of God. No, He didn't say for you to pray for Him to protect you. Why? Because He's already giving you protection. He didn't say you should pray for Him to give you grace, because He's already giving you grace. He didn't say pray, you know, so He'll give you peace. He's already giving you peace. Do you get it? So we do this, but this is what you have to know. And then 15 says, if we know that, that's the thing. Do you know? If we know that He hears us. Some people don't even know that God hears them. It's true. They've been praying, they've not seen any manifestation, answers, whatever. So they don't even know. You see, this year, I'm pleading with you to grow in your confidence towards God. Grow in your faith. The Bible says we should grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. That's 2 Peter 3:18. Grow. You have to grow. Wherever you are in your faith, wherever you are in your confidence, that is not the ultimate. You have to grow. Faith that you have received is ultimate, it's complete, it's entire, it's total. You don't need anything more. But you don't know what you have. So as you learn concerning what you have, you grow in knowledge concerning what you have. You grow in knowledge concerning how it works. You grow in knowledge concerning how you have to function and operate in what God has given you.
Amen.
That is where the issue is. So when I see people that are lackadaisical, they think they have arrived. And they, oh, they know some few scriptures. Look, even me, I'm still learning. When I say even me, I'm referring to the fact that, look, I have so much knowledge up my sleeves, maturity, but still I'm learning, I haven't arrived. When I see people, babies, people who have followed traditions and they think they have arrived, it bothers me big time. It bothers me big time. And because of the work I do, I see how people, it's difficult. They've thought along a certain line. They've operated. They've functioned. They've conducted their lives along a certain line. So now, that is not working. But they have to shift gears from what they've been doing to this new way. Jesus is the way to the truth, to begin to apply truth for things to work. And it's difficult. Like he said, habits die hard. They are difficult to be broken. Sound mind. If you be hearing truth, and you keep applying them. Look, let me tell you this. I have to slow down. It's the burden of the Lord. That's where I'm coming from. Compassion. It hurts. You guys probably have no idea to see people in bondage. I used to tell people, and I still do it. I said, don't wait till you marry. There's so much in the Word of God that it says, do this for one another. Pray for one another. Love one another. Be affectionate towards one another. Be polite towards one another. Bear one another's burden. You can go on. Things like that. This is the way God wants us to live. But we don't do this. And people take things like fasting. And they major on fasting. And every year, they begin the year by fasting. As I'm talking now, probably there's a church there, church, an assembly that is fasting. People don't do what I'm saying, the one another, whatever the Bible says, one another statements. When you do this, you are building character, or the character of God that is within you begins to surface, begins to have expression. That this becomes your way of life. And when you do something over a considerable length of time, then it becomes who you are. You see, who you are already is within you. But because of lack of knowledge, you don't know. But as you follow truth, you evolve. You keep evolving. You keep evolving into who you are. And who you are, your true identity, now begins to show forth. Character. You are conformed to the image of His dear Son, according to Romans 8:29. That is where God wants us to be. The only thing that is going to take us there is truth. Jesus is the way. The way, not our way. His way. Hallelujah. Not our will, His will. And when you do this for a long time, that's why I keep telling people things like, it's not in me. It's not in me to hate anybody. It's not in me. It's not there. It's in me to love people. It's not in me to be rude to somebody. It's not there. Because what? I have grown in that grace to be polite to people. To value people. To treasure people. To respect people. The Bible says, honor all or respect all. I've grown in that grace to respect people. No matter where they are coming from, no matter the demographics, no matter their social status, academic status, marital status, name it, whatever. No matter what. No matter the color of their skin. You see, this is truth brings you to that place. So you do this. Look, I pray that one person is not here like that. Perhaps those who didn't come to church, those who are listening to me. There are some Christians today. You can sit them down, even if you can tell you truth. You find hatred in them towards somebody. You see how rude they are to somebody. They don't even value somebody. It's like, oh, this guy, nah. And they've been sitting in church. They don't hear a word like this. So that doesn't help them to change. Hallelujah to Jesus. Like I keep telling you, Jesus himself said it. Troubles will come. You better be ready. You better be prepared. Some of the things, they hit us without announcement. No notice. But if you have truth within you, there's nothing that will come against you that you cannot handle. Nothing. Absolutely nothing. That's why we sang the song, I shall not be moved. When your heart is fixed, trust in the Lord. You are not shaken by anything. You know that you know that you know. You know whose you are. You know His ability to see you through. You know His ability to direct you. You know His ability to guide you. You know it. The confidence is established that He does a good job all the time. He always comes through. But if you've been playing church, you don't know this. Some people, they just like the music. They are in love with the music. Some people, they just love the oil. Give me the oil. What are you preaching? Give me oil. Lord, have mercy. If you know that He hears you, whatever you ask, we know that we have what? The petitions that we have asked of Him. Desired. What we have desired from Him. Hallelujah.
Amen.
This is simple. So when I know that God is not deaf, I don't go to Him and shout instructions at Him. Look at how beautiful Jesus prayed. Read your Bible. That's why we do this. Every year we have a book we are reading. And I know some of you don't read. That's fine. God knows you. That's fine. But when you read, you are going to come to terms with what I've been saying to you all this while. Look at how Jesus prayed. At certain times He was saying, Father, I know you always hear me, but for the sake of these people, I'm saying what I'm saying.
Right.
And if we know that He hears us, confidence. If we know that He hears us, hallelujah.
Amen.
Look at how simple Jesus prayed. And then you say, oh, that is Jesus. But what about the people He taught, His students? We call them apostles. Look at how they lived their life. Read the Acts of the Apostles, that book, and see how they function. And then it goes further. Not just them, the Acts of the Apostles, the immediate students of Jesus. But these students of Jesus taught other people who came to the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. And then you see the Acts of the Apostles, how they also conducted themselves. People get up and they go and read the book of Psalms. They get up and they go and read how, they go and read about Jezebel. Because they've been taught wrongly, spiritual warfare. There's a witch or something against you. So the moment they wake up, no leading, no direction from the Holy Spirit, no prompting. The first thing they begin to do, prayer. They don't even thank God. They wake up and they say the devil is a liar. You wake up from your bed, instead of saying, hallelujah, this is the day the Lord has made, and I'll be, what, I'll rejoice and be glad. You wake up and you say, I bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. You wake up and you say, thank you, I celebrate your love for me. But you wake up, then the same thing, like, the devil is a liar. In the name of Jesus, I bind any tongue that is coming against me. I cough. What is that? You're paranoid. And you're walking in paranoia. And you are confused. There's no downer. I want you to realize where you are. The devil is not even up to something. I bind you in the name of Jesus. Everywhere you are moving, if you are coming from the kitchen door, I bind you and I seal it with the blood of Jesus Christ. If it's the bedroom window, in the name of Jesus, I apply the blood of Jesus. Aye, aye, aye. I'm being dramatic about it, but that's how some people pray. Then they go and take their oil. Then they mark the, you know, bedroom window, because their fear tells them the devil is going to come through the bedroom window. The devil doesn't need a physical window or a physical door to come to you. The door is in your mind, your lack of knowledge, failure to apply truth. That is the door, not something physical. I want to say that again. The avenue, the door that the enemy used to attack, is not a physical door, it's in your soul. In your mind, your lack of what? Truth, lack of knowledge. My people will perish. Isaiah says it this way, they are in captivity. Your failure to apply truth, to know truth and to apply it. That's it. So you can oil your whole house, oil everything. That's ignorance. The devil is not afraid of the oil. Oh my goodness. Let me add to it. You oil your stuff and yet you turn around and your thinking is thinking. You are thinking contrary to what God has said. So fear, you oil your house. But yes, still, God, I'm asking you to protect me. Jesus, help me. Jesus, help me. God, I'm asking. You see, you've negated everything. Hallelujah. But when you know your word, you're not going to walk about like that. Hallelujah. Amen. You walk around, in this will I be confident. Truth, in this truth. And what God has said, in this will I be confident. Knowing that He's my shepherd. He's my protector. He's my shield. I'm covered by the blood. Angels are at work on my behalf. God has gone to a great length, great extent to secure us, to protect us. And we don't know it because we are not taught. And so believers, some people feel they are weak. So all the time they go to God, strengthen me, strengthen me, strengthen me. Friday I was talking about it. David strengthened himself. He didn't have to pray, God, strengthen me. Wake up. That was even in the Old Testament. He didn't pray, God, strengthen me. In 1 Samuel chapter 36, look at what we're talking about from verse 1. His city was burned down. Your house is not burnt, and we are not praying for that. His whole city burned down. His wives, two wives, children, and then his people, their wives, their children were taken too. And they all began to cry. Come see men cry. If you haven't seen one before, go read First Samuel chapter 30 from verse 1. They cried. Bible says they cried till they had no power to cry. And the situation was so alarming that they decided to kill. You know, those days when they say they are going to stone somebody, it means they are going to kill the person. He wanted to stone David. God saved him. God protected him. And what did David do? The Bible says he encouraged himself in the Lord. He strengthened himself in the Lord. Please wake up. Shift gears. It takes faith. It takes knowledge to wake up. I'm going to teach you some things now. You see, when you wake up and you say, Father, I thank you for your love for me. I celebrate your faithfulness towards me. I celebrate your mercies. Thank you for endowing me with abilities, with graces, with gifts. Thank you for making me able. There will be people read scriptures like, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Philippians 4:13. And yet, they don't apply it. Oh, they know. They can quote you. They can say everything there. They can quote it. Oh, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. But they don't rely on it. Meaning they don't believe it. When you believe the word, it means you rely on it. Hallelujah. Amen. That is why I don't have a necklace that gives me good luck. What I have is more than good luck. I'm blessed. I'm favored by the Lord. I don't need a talisman. That's spiritism. I don't need a special ring on my finger. So when I pray for people, it will work. No. The one who called me has enabled me. When I pray, he answers. We have a covenant. We have some connection. We have a relationship. Hallelujah. That's how simple it is. I don't have to wear anything on my waist. I don't have to go kill any animal and have some idol in my house so you can prophesy. You don't need all that. People pray and they pray wrongly instead of thanking God for what they have received already. So like you are hearing me, let's go to, oh, this is delaying me. I have stuff to share. Let's go to John chapter 1. Let's take it from 14. And the word became flesh. John 1, 14. But because somebody's learning, I'm not here to impress people. So because somebody's learning, I'll take my time. And the word became flesh and dwelt amongst us, talking about Jesus. And we beheld his glory, the glory of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. Full of what? Full of what? Hallelujah. Amen. He's full of what? Grace and truth. Now let's back up to verse 12. He's full of grace and truth. Look at verse 12. 11 says, he came to his own received him not, or his own did not receive him. But 12 says, but as many as received him, who is that? As many as received, who are we talking about? Him is what? Jesus. To them he gave the right to become children of God. Wow. To those who believe in his name. So when we believed him, meaning that when we trusted him, let's have other translations. Let's do New Living Translation so people will get it. The one who believe in his name, you know. But all who believe in him and accepted him, that is key. Oh, I can use this analogy. Every woman, I believe, has experienced this somewhere along their lives. You have your desire, and you have picture perfect. You have a solid outline of the kind of man you want to marry, or the one who should even, make an attempt to try to date you. So when this man shows up, I'm talking to the women now. When this person shows up, you have your imagination, you have your picture perfect, you have all your things there. And like a light switch that is turned on, everything comes on. And then you analyze the person, you evaluate them. And all of a sudden, then you look at them like this, from peripheral. Like you, it's like, don't even try. Yes, don't even try. So here, it means that you have not received the person. But somebody may also approach you. I'm talking to the lady still. And the moment he tells himself, oh, he's fine. He hasn't even said a word. He's fine. You have accepted the present world already. So it's like, okay, now say it. What do you want to say? Say it, say it. I'm ready. Say it, say it. So they don't even finish their sentence. Say, all right, we can go out. That'll be fine. I'm available. That's fine. Oh, what day are you looking at? That's fine. We call that acceptance. You received a person. And so you went out on that date. That's how you receive Christ. You receive his word. You rely on it. You work with it. That's what it is. That's how simple it is. And I want to add to this. When you accepted him, when you received him, remember, he's full of what? He's full of what? Not only grace. Come on, don't do that to me. He's full of what? Grace and truth. Jesus doesn't come to you, or you don't accept Jesus. He doesn't come into union with you. And then when he comes only with grace, and he leaves truth behind the door. And he says, oh, I'm looking at you. I'm giving you, I'm probation now. I'm looking at you. Depending on how you handle your life, then okay, I'll add truth to it. Do you get what I'm saying? When you received him, you received a complete total package. Grace and truth. Everything that you ever need to know that is called truth is in you, but it's in your spirit. It's not in your head. It's not in your brains yet. It's not in your mind or in your mind yet. It's in your spirit. Because it's your spirit that is born. Born again. Regenerated. It's your spirit that has the connection with God. God speaks to your spirit. So as you are taught, like I'm doing now, you see, everything that you need to know, no wonder you hear certain things, it resonates with you. There's agreement. Your spirit tells you, okay, this is it. This is it. But at times your head, because you've not come into knowledge or exposure of truth, your head will be fighting it. Will be fighting it. Like when I started talking to some pastors about this thing, you don't have to pray for God to anoint you. I mean, they fought me to the nail with scriptures that are bogus. Let me put it that way. They said, yo, you're anointed when you fast. If the anointing comes by fasting, you have to fast every day to be anointed. You see, you are going to work. God has given us stuff, and instead of thanking him, we think our good works or our own something will get God to give us something. And so we do things that God has not asked us to do. Friday, I tackled a similar thing. Jesus himself said, ask, and it shall be given. Seek and you shall find. Knock and it shall be open. I took those three words, I broke them down very well. Hallelujah. People say when you are going to ask from God, you have to add fasting to it. Why? God is not stupid. God is not ignorant, like some people think he is. If Jesus wanted us to add fasting, attach fasting, to we coming to him to ask him for anything, he would have said it. Jesus is not bold. Jesus is not direct. Jesus is not a wimp. Jesus is not a sissy. Jesus is not insecure to say exactly what he means and means what he says. Let's get over this nonsense. Let's get over this ignorance. Let's come out of this bondage. For years, decades, it's been practiced, but it's not Bible. Your own children, when they come to ask you for something, do you tell them go and fast before? And he said that in Mark, when you read it, Matthew 7, from verse 9 and 10. Then he says, which of you, when you evil people, your son will come to you, or daughter will come to you and ask for a fish, then you are going to give them something else. Food, then you give them stone. We don't do that. So why do we treat God that way? Who told us a lie? Why have we believed a lie? I understand. Somebody told a lie. You have the responsibility to reject it. Don't take it. Don't. You can go to God. You know how we go to God? Because of what Jesus has done, he pacified God. We are clean before him. God can't wait for us to jump into his arms. He says, come boldly to the throne of grace. Then we say fasting. And people are still fasting to ask God for something. Hallelujah. Some people are so entrenched in what? Traditions. And then wrong teachings. You know why? Let me tell you why. This is serious. This is deep. That is why some people, it takes them a long time. Because when you have heresy, can I do this? I don't want to be jumping about. When you have heresy, you are teaching some wrong doctrine, and you believe it, so a different Jesus is introduced to you, a different Savior, a different God. A different spirit is introduced to you. And that spirit wants to keep you captive. That's what happens. So some of these pastors are deceived. They are in captivity. And they don't even know. If you like, visit. Okay, now because of the pandemic. You go online and listen to some of the preachings. You know what I'm talking about. I do this. I'm a researcher. A spiritual researcher. Because of the work he's called me to do, I do that. I intentionally look at certain things. I investigate. Because I've worked with the FBI before. No, I'm talking about a spiritual investigation. So you see it for yourself. You know it. And then you can help people out. This is dangerous. So when you're receiving grace and what? Truth is within you. You can always find truth within yourself. I'm talking about the believer, not the one who is not born again. The way to do it, that is so easy, read the word. I'm going to say something bold. You have to read the whole Bible. But for you as a believer, born again, probably just start in the New Testament. Start from Matthew. Read Matthew and go all the way down. And then when you finish that, you can go and start from Genesis, and it will make sense to you. And where you are is in the New Testament, the church. Like when I started, Aaron, the prayer that he prayed was specifically for the Israel, children of Israel, all right, for that time. Aaron is not my high priest. Pastors all over the world, those who are teaching this wrong thing, Aaron, it's not your high priest. Your high priest is the Lord Jesus Christ. According to Hebrews chapter 3. We'll come back to this. We haven't finished the job. We'll go back to the 14. But let's read the Hebrews 3. This will be the... Look, I'll say this to you. Spiritual leaders are one of the... one class of people that they struggle with change. They want to see change with their followers, their congregants, but then they are not that quick to change because they are entrenched in their ways. Hallelujah. Let's go to Hebrews 3 from 1. Therefore, holy brethren, partakers of the heavenly calling, consider the apostle and high priest of our confession. Who is that? Christ Jesus. God is not stupid. If in the New Testament, New Covenant, if he should be what? Aaron, he would have said it. So you see the line? We believe the wrong thing. I'm talking about those who have believed that. So, okay, let me read it again. Put a spin on it. Therefore, holy brethren, partakers of the heavenly calling, consider the apostle and high priest. You shouldn't even read the apostle. The high priest of your confession, Aaron. He didn't say Aaron, but he says Christ Jesus. Christ Jesus, not Aaron. Now, you know what? The Aaronic blessing doesn't count anymore if you're a child of God. Because the greater one than Aaron is the one that has blessed you because you are in union with him. Hallelujah. And that blessing doesn't have to be pronounced on you every day. He pronounced it once because you came to union with him. Is there forever. His presence in you, he indwelling you, is the seal, the Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. So, I don't walk about. I used to be like some people who were ignorant many, many years ago. Then you too, I used to pray for blessing. But now that I know it, I don't. I know that I'm a blessed person and I walk in this blessing. Hallelujah. It makes you audacious. Audacious. Hallelujah.
Amen.
So it's Jesus Christ. Do you see? I just have it there to read it for people to know, so not error. Alright. Now let's go back to the John that we're reading. Let's see if we can do justice to that. So let's go back to John chapter 1, verse 14. The Word became flesh and dwells amongst us, full of what? Grace and truth. Let's read on. 15. John bore witness of him. So this, the guy lived. Because somebody saw him. Somebody is a witness. Not just one person. A lot of people. And cried out saying, this was he of whom I said, he who comes after me is preferred before me. Look at this. For he was before me. He's the eternal one. Not Aaron. Aaron died. Let's continue. 16. And of his fullness, not your lack, not from your works, that can pacify God, please God, of his fullness, we have all received. What have we received? Grace for grace. So if you have received, if you've been reading by now, you should know that you have received. Because as many as received him, you have received grace. He is grace himself. He is what? Truth. And he is in you. You are in union with him. How dare you ask for grace? Pray for grace and you think you are doing something. Ask some parents. Children come to them, they ask them for something, they give them, and even children, they know. The moment they receive it, they don't even have time to say thank you. They run off. They take off. And then grown men and women, they can't read this simple English. This is why you say the devil is a liar. He's blinding some people. This is why you can say the devil is a liar. He's blinding some people not to see. We have all received, not going to receive, but we have all received. This is simple English. True or false? Grace. The word grace is loaded. Let me see if I can give you this analogy so you get it. You are not an afterthought. You are not here by accident. Alright, so when God created you, he had something in mind for you specifically to represent and to do, so far as his purpose, his will is concerned. So he wired you. That is why when a mother conceives, the nose, the eyes, help me out. Follow. That's how you do it. I mentioned don't mention the nose, don't mention the eyes, because I mentioned that I'm talking about the parts of the body. So the nose, the eyes, throw me some. Come on now, do it. The nose, the eyes, the what? The ears. The teeth, the toes. Go ahead. Stomach. Some people like food. Stomach. And then what? Head. So everything. Do you see all these things in what we call seed? You don't see it, but they are there. In the seed, all these things that we have mentioned, they are there, even though it's not visible yet to the physical eyes. That's God. So the fact that you don't see the blessing because you are accustomed to, you are used to seeing things before you believe. So if you don't show me the money, don't tell me you are rich. I'm rich. Don't tell me that. You want to see the money? You don't have to see it. The Bible says in the book of 2 Corinthians, chapter 8, verse 9, if I'm not mistaken, for we know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, how he is rich, yet for our sakes he became poor, that we might become what? Rich. You have to believe these things. Truth. Hallelujah.
Amen.
That we might become rich. Rich is rich. Rich in everything. Rich in every way. Period.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
So you see yourself that way. You think that way. You don't walk around with your head back. I don't know why I'm going through. So everybody hates me. Everybody doesn't like me. And everybody is being mean to me. Don't focus on them. You are accepted in the beloved. If God has accepted you, whoever wants to be against you, let them be against you. They'll get tired. They'll get fed up. Whatever they are doing against you, it's not going to work. Don't give them power by thinking about them. Don't let them hold you back. Don't let them stop you by you thinking about the nonsense that they are doing. They are not that important. God is.
Amen.
His word is.
Yes.
Think about God. Think about his word. Amen. Not some foolish person, what they are doing. Some ignorant person who is lost in their own world and they need a savior. You don't like what I'm saying? Okay, that's fine. Because I know some of you, the people who are coming against you say, oh, pastor, are you saying that my old brother is foolish, your sister is foolish? Yes, that's exactly what I'm saying. Scripture tells me to tell you that. If you are not hearing the word or hear the word, you don't do it. You are like a foolish person. Amplify says, stupid person. Who is this guy, right? Okay, that's fine. So of his fullness we have received. You have it. Look at it. I'm not touched to my stuff. Look at Romans chapter 5. Oh, dear Lord, hallelujah. Romans chapter 5, verse 1.
I'll speed up along the line.
How far have I done? Have I done 50 minutes, 40 minutes? God, I don't want to stretch it. What have I done so far? How many minutes? 50 minutes? Oh. Okay, almost 50. Therefore, having been justified by faith, how are we justified? By faith. Not by our works. Faith is believing in him, like I said from the beginning. We have what? We have what? Peace with God. Right standing with God. Right standing. We have peace. And not just we have right standing with God. This peace of God is in us. That is why in Galatians chapter 5, he says that we can bear the fruit of the Spirit. Peace is part of the fruit of the Spirit. Because it's, see, an apple tree will bring forth apple what? Fruit. So in Galatians, the Bible says we can what? Demonstrate, bear the fruit of the Spirit. It starts with love, joy, peace. Peace is part of the fruit. If you don't have it, how are you going to produce it? If the seed is not there, how are you going to produce it? The peace, the Prince of Peace, peace himself is within you. And if you walk in line with him, then of course you are going to exhibit what? Peace. You are going to manifest peace. Hallelujah. That's how simple it is. He's there. He's there. You see, take it this way. The parts of the body. Christ is in you, or the Holy Spirit is in you. He's there with all, you see, the parts of the body. It's not like he's in there, oh, he forgot to add his arms to it. Or he forgot to add his legs. So it's like, oh, okay, by way of function, I have this ability, I can see because I have the eyes. Oh, I can smell. Oh, but I can walk because he didn't give me the legs. No, he's there, total, complete. So you have ability. You are enabled. You are empowered. Grace to be everything that God wants you to be.
Amen.
And also to do everything that God wants you to do.
Amen.
Years ago, many, many years ago, especially in my teenage years, I used to fast. And the purpose of the fast, God used me. God anointed me. God gave me power. God gave me wisdom. Just like you gave to Solomon, and he was able to rule your people, so God gave you wisdom. I prayed that prayer out of ignorance. That's what I was taught. I believed the person teaching me, and I took it. But along the line, I got enlightened. As I read the word of God, and I fellowship with the Holy Spirit, my eyes were open. And I realized that I'm asking God for all these things that he's already given me. He's already, you see, oh, hallelujah. You're already anointed to do what he wants you to do. You have the ability to do what he wants you to do.
Yeah.
Like I'm standing before you, I'm a male. He gave me ability, he wired me to be a male. I can't be a woman. I can't be a female because I don't have that ability. God didn't wire me that way. I can pretend and talk, and I see you tomorrow.
Oh.
But it's fake. It's fake. And you're I'm talking to you. You're pretending. I mean, you're getting tired because it's too much. But it's in me to be a male. I'm enabled by God. Show me. I don't remember the day that I fasted, God make me a male. And when I wake up, I pray, God, remember, today, this Friday, I'm going out. Give me the power, the ability to be a male. Never once. And you people, you're taking it for granted. That's what people are doing spiritually. They have things they don't even know that they have. As I'm talking to you, some people are here. The Friday lesson, they haven't listened to it. How do you grow in your confidence, in your faith, in your walk with the Lord? You are busy about everything. One thing that is important, more important than anything, is the word. He said that, Jesus said, Martha, Martha. You are busy, you are worried about a lot of things. One thing is important. And what? Mary has chosen that. The word. Give attention to the word. Look, if I haven't done that, I won't be where I'm standing today. Now let me talk to you about something. Let me open up some few things for you. I won't go much. I don't want to scare you. People talk about attacks. They'll say, oh, probably, Pastor, you're not dealing with things. You know, you don't have things coming against you. I've known from day one. When I came like 7 years, 5 years, because God was using me. 5 years, 7 years, he was still using me, but I didn't know anything. I didn't have knowledge because you are born with the giftings. So you have to study to have knowledge. And look, it was so difficult to stay in school because the devil kept attacking me, said that it was during exams. I was sick very often, very sick, sick all the time, especially exam time. And I remember some of the exams that I wrote, I wasn't well, but I stayed in class, I wrote the exams, I was an A-plus kind of student, and I stayed there and I did that, but it was the devil. See, I've known because prophecies have gone over my life when I was even in the womb of my mom. And then because of that, I know that I've become a target of the enemy. That is why, look, I don't joke with these things. I've lived this thing for over 4 decades. I know what I'm talking about. You see, if I don't rely on God and I rely on my own strength, I don't think I'll be standing before you. I don't think so. Because the things that I've got, I won't go into this, I won't talk about it. I was going to tell you. Look, I've had dreams before where like there will be some kind of fight in the dream and you are touched or you are cut or whatever and I'll wake up, I'm talking about my teenage years, and you see blood, really, blood, literally blood. Talking about physical. I can talk to you about things. I don't play with the word of God. I don't play with God. He's my source, my protection. That's where it comes from. I don't care what somebody's doing. So far as I'm fine with God, I don't care. Do it. You will never succeed. That's what the word of God tells me. I don't bother. Well, what is he doing? Is he saying something against me? You say it. You see, I have a protection against all those things.
Amen.
I don't have to show me where Jesus was walking around. And then he said, oh, someone is trying to attack me. Judas was in his camp. Judas. Tell me when he stood up, Judas, and laid hands, and Judas, I command this spirit that is in you to come. No, he didn't. Look, Judas was marginalized. Because in the presence, in the power, in the anointing of God, no demonic activity can prevail. Nothing. People don't know these things. I don't pray for people like I should. You come to me, I'll teach you how to pray. And I'll teach you how to help others also to pray. I want you to have confidence in the God that you are related with. Amen. Hallelujah. These are simple things. Simple stuff. I've seen all kinds of things. I'm still standing here. Hallelujah. I don't say these things because I don't want to scare people. And I don't want people to think so much about the demonic. I used to be, many years ago it was like that. Because things were happening. And so you will focus on that. Have you met some Christians always they are telling the devil is attacking me, the devil is attacking the devil? That's not that you know. When you come into knowledge, you will stop saying that. Because that will not be even be happening. They attack, they will stab. It will be dead on arrival. It's just simple. Hallelujah. I came to just tell you this simple thing. According to your faith, salvation to start with is according to your faith. Because Ephesians 2:8, guys, work with me quickly. How to stop? Ephesians 2, I can say that, but I want people to see it. Because I've come to realize that you say these scriptures, people write it down. No disrespect to people who take notes or whatever. They go and they don't study. They write it down, they go and put the book somewhere, the journal somewhere. The angels will read it for them when they are sleeping. Hallelujah. I thought you were going to clap for me for saying that. Okay, let's. Ephesians 2, 8. New King James Version. For by what? Grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. And it's full of what? Grace and truth. No Aaron, no Moses. For by grace you have been what? Saved through faith. Moses led the people of Israel out of a specific geographical location, but Jesus Christ came to lead the whole world out of bondage into the very kingdom of God. That's the difference. So those who go through on the Old Testament and they stay there and they pray those prayers and watch it, and they're not of yourselves. It is the gift of God. Gift. Can you say gift of God? What is the gift of God? Here, what we're talking about. Gift. What is that gift? You see? This is what people do. They read. I read the Bible this morning. What did you read? Oh, the Bible is talking that we are saved by grace and and then that's it. You see, you have to ask, you probe. So here, it's not of ourselves. It's not of ourselves. It is the gift of God. Now, I'll touch on something before I stop. Gift of God. What is our responsibility when someone gives you a gift? You have the right to receive or to reject it, right? The choice is yours. So when you receive it, you have acknowledged the gift. And that's why you say, thank you. I appreciate what you have done. Two of us. That is also the way we receive from God. When you hear truth, you acknowledge it in your heart. Not just, oh, you see, I have to be nice. I was really upset. I didn't want him to, I didn't want her to do this, but you see, I had to be nice. So, you know, I just say, oh, thank you. Thank you for, oh, that's so nice. Oh, that's so thoughtful. You know, there are some people like that. I hope I'm not talking to you. Oh, that's so nice of you. That's so thoughtful. But then, look at verse 9. I'm talking about receiving acknowledging, not of works, lest any one should boast. Not your works. He has finished the work. You believe in him. Hallelujah. Acts 16:31. When the jail prison was opened and Paul and Silas came out. Let's read 13 first. I want us to have a Acts 16, 1, 6, 13. And he brought them out and said, sirs, what must we do to be saved? Because they were going to, the guys were going to kill themselves because the prison doors were open. They thought that Paul and Silas, they've escaped. But they were standing right. Says, no, no, don't do this. Then so they asked them, says, what must we do to be saved? Listen to this carefully. Look at the question. What must I do to be saved? For all those who are out there, and Christians, spiritual leaders, who are creating havoc in the system, what must I do to be saved? Let's read on. 31. So they said, go and fast for a day. Give a seed. Go and anoint yourself. Pray just an hour, 2 hours, 4 hours a day. And then you'll be saved. But it says, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. And you'll be saved. Do what? Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. And what will happen? You'll be saved. Let me tell you quickly what this word means. I don't want to make a mistake. I can just tell you that, but I want to make sure I check my notes and I say it well. Hallelujah. Amen. And if you miss anything, go back, listen to the CD, and you'll be fine. Hallelujah. Okay. This is what Paul said. Believe and you shall be saved. All right. Is that not what they said in John 1:12 that we read? As many as received him, believe in him, they were saved. Then let's look at John 3:16. We toy with this, but it's a fact. It says, for God so loved the world. John 3:16. Let's go there. John 3 says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whoever believes in him should not do what? Perish, but have everlasting life. Okay, everlasting life, the eternal life. You are saved, and it's the life of God. What we say, the life of God, there's peace in the life of God. There's love in the life of God. Protection in the life of God. Preservation in the life of God. Look at God, and then you can have a picture of what you have received. But he left you here because you are his partner. He has to do something on earth, and he needs the people to do it. And the people he has chosen is his church. Those who accept Jesus Christ as their Savior. Those who are cleansed, they have become his tabernacle. The Bible says in 1 Corinthians, don't go there because we're working on it. 1 Corinthians 3, 9, the Bible says we are partners with God. We are God's fellow workers. So we are working with God. He's giving us the power of attorney to represent him here. Everything he does on earth, he does it through the church. That is why it's important for every believer to know who they are in Christ. How they are wired, how they are gifted, how they are anointed, the abilities, the graces they carry. It's not just going to some church and saying, I belong to this church, I belong to this denomination. And meanwhile, you are nothing. When I say nothing, you are not productive. Look at 17. Zoe, that's the life we're talking about. Greek, eternal life. Look at this. For God did not send his son into the world to do what? To condemn the world, but that the world through him might be what? Okay, like I've been saying, salvation is a total package. The word save, that's what I'm going to tell you, so you know this forever. It's spelled S-O-Z-O, but it's pronounced S-O-D-Z-O, so Zo. Okay, and it means this, save. When God says save is safe, that is deliver or protect. Literally or figuratively, heal, preserve, do well, be made or be or make whole, right? That's what it means. Do you get it? So, save. Salvation means deliverance. Yeah, safe or safety, deliverance, protection, health or healing, preservation, prosperity, doing well. Wholeness, nothing missing, nothing broken. That's why we get the word peace, shalom. Whole, everything is intact. So, through him, my reward, saved. Now, I was going to tell you how we do all these things. It comes by you believing. If you don't believe, this doesn't become possible. Preservation. That's why some people are still confused. They are in the faith, but they don't believe what they have received. So they keep asking for. But if you believe, because if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you shall be saved. That's Romans 10:9. See, the same word, sozo, saved. Salvation, soteria. Hallelujah. Then 10 says, for with the what? Heart, man believes. It's important that you believe in your heart. Okay? You believe in your heart. And then your mouth, confession is made unto salvation. Then in the verse 9, what it says, if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart. To confess, the Hebrew word used is homologeo. Alright? That means to assent, to acknowledge, to what? Give thanks, to praise. And it means to say the same thing as God has said. To say the same, to give thanks, to say the same, to acknowledge. So if you believe it, you say the same. If you believe it, you say the same, you think the same, you imagine the same. You'll be thanking him. But because you don't believe it, you keep asking and you are not thanking him for the gift of protection. You see, the gift, your life, salvation is a gift. Within that gift of God is protection. Within that gift of God is preservation. Within that gift of God is healing. Within that gift of God is help. Hallelujah. And the Bible says it's according to what? Your faith. He told blind Bartimaeus, according to your faith, you've been made whole. The lady that with the issue of what? Blood, according to your faith. He said, go pray. He said, go fast. He said, go give. Go anoint your house. Go do this. No, none of those things. You have to release your faith. Meaning, believe the word. Accept the word. Your confidence in the one who is speaking to you. And confidence and reliance on his word to you. That's it. That's it. According to your faith. I'll continue. Because I haven't finished this. I want to break things down so nobody will ever be led astray. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. And I'm going to charge you with these words from Galatians chapter 5, verse 1 and 13. Stand firm in the liberty wherewith Jesus, the anointed one, has made you free. And do not be again entangled with the yoke of bondage, but by love serve one another. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah. The truth is marching on. Praise God, praise God, praise God.